glove compartment. In a 1993 Lincoln, there's a glove compartment in the driver's door, there's a glove compartment in the passenger door, and then there's a glove compartment in the dashboard. Now call Brad Richard Sachs, successor trustee, one, for the Glendora Franklin Living Trust, for the preservation of the Glendora Franklin Pro Se Public Access Newspaper Museum. Bruce Leonard Bergman is successor trustee two. Please call him. And call our banker, where the trust fund is. And Glendora's brother is Gordon Howard Folsom, and his son is Stephen, and Stephen's wife is Terry, and terryloves.com cat, and will take care of .com if anything should happen that Bonnie Sutherland needs a successor. Terry will take care of the two big plants, the mother plant and Franklin 3. The mother plant had three children, Franklin 1, Franklin 2, and Franklin 3. Franklin 1 we found a good home for, Franklin 2 we found a good home for, and Franklin 3 is in the church with the big cathedral ceilings. Terry loves plants as she does cats. The plants are so huge, they are stationed at Kinderhook Reformed Church. And here's the telephone numbers for the Kinderhook Reformed Church. What do you think of this, folks? Have I done it wrong? It's kind of fun. It's kind of fun to make sure, just to have some assurance that things will be perpetuated and preserved. Tanya Hunter will check the museum every week or so, inside and out, to see what maintenance may be needed. And she will call Brad Sachs or Bruce Bergman to finance the repairs. Now Michael Buick, Valencia postal clerk, has acquiesced to assist Tanya. Michael is interesting. He comes from Buffalo. He lived in Kenmore. His grandmother lived in Kenmore. And he used to deliver the Buffalo Evening News. And Franklin, he remembered Franklin's byline. Franklin was a reporter for the Buffalo Evening News for 27 years and 10 years for the Springfield, Massachusetts Union. Patrice Lyons, fellow congregant of Vesta, has also been kind enough to do maintenance monitoring. Another kind helper is Maureen Mooney, and Andrew Hersman is in Long Island said once, "A chat with Glendora is interesting." TV now, and will continue to be interesting after you are gone. Further, Andrew said, "I'll keep your show going." Isn't that wonderful? He said all he needs is a list of the TV stations, the tapes, and the addresses. Isn't that nice? He's the technical director for Court TV. The owner of these delightful 3 acres we live on and hope to die on lives next door. I wish I were living. I had so much fun every day. I can't believe it is over. His vacation home number is in the Adirondacks somewhere. And neighbor Mary Kilser knows much about Glendora's postmortem desires. And Brad Sachs is a lawyer, so don't hold that against him, please. He was ardently devoted to Franklin. They met in 1983. That would be what? 30 years ago? And they were even more ardently devoted to baseball. They were incorrigibly afflicted. And Brad is a Yankees fan. And Franklin is eclectic. He loved them all. Will somebody go to the Stuyvesant town clerk and get the death certificate? Shannon and Sean will see that it is set up with a clerk, and they'll probably pay for it, but don't let them do that. Let the trust fund pay for it. Please make 10 copies and leave them in the museum and note where you filed them. Jane Dean, a neighbor to the north, and husband John may help, and Bonnie Dunham may help. It would be nice if Tanya Hunter would co-sign on box 124 Ghent, New York, and keep it going for a while. And I think you should keep 914-949-9495 going. And the keys to the post office box are in the 1993 Lincoln driver's glove compartment. 35 is reserved, and do you have any additions or corrections? Glendora Vesta, 914-949-9495. Yes, it would be nice to keep 914-949-949 going for a while. And answer the phone, the calls, and return them. And Connie Whitaker, at 37 Ogden Street, White Plains, New York, knows a lot about us and Franklin, and I know Bob and Connie from the church in the Highlands Congregational since 1983. These are all such fun things to do. You can't wait until I die to do them, right? Go to the White Stone Cafe, Route 66 and 21, and have a feast. And don't eat animal products, though. And ask Bruce or Brad to pay. It will be interesting to observe our parents, Mother Nature and Father Time, and the work that their adversities on these careful plans. Jim Berger works at Manders Fireplace on the property, and he is going to be a good repair person. So, the museum rent is $75 per month and is due on the 9th of the month and goes until the 8th of the next month. And don't forget to call Social Security and Gannett to stay the payments. Glendora is not here anymore. That's fun, folks. You wouldn't think it was fun, would you? But it is. You should do it. I'm telling you, when you die, people are going to be bereaved. And they don't want, they're not in any position or a condition or mental state to resolve these things. Have it all in writing for them. And they can just follow it. What did the eye doctor say to the Japanese man? You have a cataract. And the Japanese man says, no, I have a Rinkan. Did you hear about the couple that got married so late in life? Medicare picked up 80% of the honeymoon. So are you going to miss me when I die? Well, you can still talk to me. Before I die, I want you happy. I want you every day to go along with God. The first thing. God's got a great big present there for you. You just don't know all of the wealth and all the richness and all the goodness and all the beauty and all the harmony and all the success and all the joy and the satisfaction and the applause and the appreciation. And you just don't know it that God has in this package for you. You don't even know where to find the Christmas tree where it is, do you? Because you're not looking for it. Your mind is scattered on trivia. Second rate. Negative. You're driving all around going to stores? Well, what can So here is a paper that was just posted February 15, 2006, Anno Domini, United States District Court, District of Idaho, Lundor Plaintiff versus Stephen G. Toman et al. Defendants.
Civil number 050488F, Edward J. Lodge. Memorandum and further support for instant summary judgment against the James Reynolds defendants.
I'm all against anti-vivisection. I am all against it. And I'm all against every cruelty to animals. Well, I met Susan's mother and dad in the laundromat. And we had great... She said that she watched the program, and what she liked about the program was .com. .com has many fans, and that's what she liked about the program. And so we got to talking about cats, and she was telling me how her daughter Susan in Peekskill rescues cats, and she does. She does it all, folks. She sets these traps for them and rescues them and then takes them out to be spayed or neutered, and then finds the homes for them. That's perfect. That's the ultimate. Thank you, Susan Hayward, in Peekskill. So she's somebody that I admire and regard with esteem and highest approbation. And I wanted her to be my signer in Peekskill. I have my program on Peekskill Cablevision. That's the kind of person that I wanted. And I invited her to do it, and she had done it. Now, tomorrow is March 11th, and Susan Hayward is coming up to see her parents, who live in Ghent. And we're all going out to dinner at the White Stone Cafe. And I was talking to her mother over the phone, and something her mother said, and I said, you know, life is very interesting. And her mother says, it is. And she says, I'm realizing that more and more since we met you. Now there's friendship. So Susan sent you this. I assume she wanted you to hear it. It says, a newly discovered chapter in the book of Genesis has provided the answer to where do pets come from? This is a March wind. Adam and Eve said, Lord, when we were in the garden, you walked with us every day. And now we do not see you anymore. And we are lonesome here, and it is difficult for us to remember how much you love us. And God said, well, I will create a companion for you that will be with you and who will be a reflection of my love for you, so that you will love me even when you cannot see me. Regardless of how selfish or childish or unlovable you may be, this new companion will accept you as you are and will love you as I do, in spite of yourselves. I guess that puts us in our place, doesn't it? And God created a new animal to be a companion for Adam and Eve. And it was a good animal. And God was pleased. And the new animal was pleased to be with Adam and Eve, and he wagged his tail. And Adam says, Lord, I have already named all the animals in the kingdom, and I cannot think of a name for this new animal. And God says, I have created this new animal to be a reflection of my love for you. His name will be a reflection of my own name, and you will call him Dog. G-O-D-E-O-G. And Dog lived with Adam and Eve and was a companion to them and loved them. And they were comforted. And God was pleased. And Dog was content and wagged his tail. That's something we can't do. You can't wag a tail, but dogs can. And after a while it came to pass that on an angel came to the Lord and said, Lord, Adam and Eve have become filled with pride. They strut and preen like peacocks, and they believe they are worthy of adoration. Dog has indeed taught them that they are loved, but perhaps too well. And God said, I will create for them a companion who will be with them and who will see them as they are. The companion will remind them of their limitations, so they will know that they are not always worthy of adoration. And God created cat, C-A-T, to be a companion of Adam and Eve. And cat would not obey them. And when Adam and Eve gazed into cat's eyes, they were reminded that they were not the supreme beings. And Adam and Eve learned humility. And they were greatly improved. And God was pleased. And dog was happy. And cat didn't give a hoot one way or the other. Thank you, Susan Hayward. She says, you give me laughs, I wanted to give you laughs. And if you are a cat lover, you know that fits the bill exactly. Now let's put this somewhere and your leg of the chair so it won't blow off. And I want to get on to videotaping for you what is the most important thing in your life, and that is that you be 100% happy. And we have a devotion to bring you up to that. And we have our clock here, and what are we going to do at 10:30? Right! We're going to rejoice. Every 15 minutes of our lives, we're going to rejoice about something. So here is the devotion. I don't know if I can get your music going for you. I think your music is very, very important. Here comes a flock of geese. I wonder if Mother Goose is there. No. I pray for you a lot. I pray for all of us a lot. I want you to be 100%. I want you to be 100% happy. I want you to be 100% successful, 100% loved, 100% appreciated, 100% applauded. I want you to be 100%. We're going around half of the time at 50%, if it's even that. And why? Because we're looking at the wrong things and we're going in the wrong directions. We have to make the connection. We have to make that connection. We have to make the connection of our oneness with God. I don't think it's so much
a matter of worshiping God. I think it's a matter of knowing that you are one with God and finding that out. And it's a matter of going to the Christmas tree where God left you a great big box full of riches, and you can't find your way to the Christmas tree. We have to just work on it and think about it. And don't think about bad things 2 minutes before we rejoice. Don't think about bad things. Don't think about ugly things, second level or trivial. Keep that oneness with God. Keep thinking about it. It's yours, and it's been covered up and smothered by all kinds of dirt and ugliness. Everybody. So that on every encounter with everybody, you will be 100%. And that is our prayer. That is our prayer, that you will be 100% and that you will overcome this illness of yours. The illness being that you think about bad things, you do dumb things, you go to movies, you watch television, you drink, you smoke, you do everything to keep you away from God. Cut that out. These prayers are for you. Stop it. Clear away all of the rubbish that's in front of you, between you and God. Clear it out with your alone time with God every morning. First thing. And clear that all out. Now, I didn't bring out a Glendora Happy book, but that certainly helps you. There are a few Glendora Happy books left. If you want one, call and ask for a free Glendora Happy book. We're putting this onto the internet. On the internet, there's billions of sites. So we're just a voice in the wilderness, but we're hoping that people will see us. Because more than anything, we want us all to be the rich and wonderful and perfect people that we can be when we go in the right direction and when we do the right things, which is to think right and to speak right and to move right. We want you to have it. We're filled with the Holy Spirit. We want you to be filled with the Holy Spirit and reach your ultimate, your 100% capacity. What is your tank register? You know, you have a gas tank in your car. What does it register? Does it register full? Does it register empty? Does it register half full? Keep at it. Work at it. You've got all the power and all the ability to do it. You are a great creation. So let's not go around with a tank that's not full on every encounter. These are beautiful. These are beautiful things in Paul's letter to the Philippians. Who are the Philippians? Well, the church at Philippi was founded as a result of Paul's first ministry foray outside of Asia Minor and the Middle East. It represented the first gospel beachhead in Europe and was fundamental to the spread of the message of Christ in Greece. So Philippi is pretty important. And remember now, Paul's in jail and he's writing this. Sometimes jail is not a bad place to be. It makes you turn to what is right. And when you go to jail, I don't think they can take away that box of gifts that God has for you under the Christmas tree. I don't think they can get at it. If you're in the right mind, and they don't do anything to hurt you mentally, but they've been known to do that. It says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but how much more to any absence, and work out your own salvation. We want you to have your salvation, and we want you to work it out, and we pray for you to work it out. It's probably the prayer that will do it. Maybe it's nothing that you will do. It may be the prayer that will do it, the grace of God. So in God's presence, work out your own salvation. But I think it goes farther than being in God's presence, folks. I think it goes farther than that. God's presence is not enough. it's God's oneness. I think God wants you to be one with God and not have anything separate you from that. What do you think? God who works in you both. And that's what we're trying to do right now, is stir up the God inside of you, working within you. And do all things without complaining or disputing, and you will, when you find that richness and that greatness that's inside of you. Blameless and harmless. Wouldn't you like to be blameless and harmless? Let's all be blameless and harmless. That's what we need, blameless and harmless, without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. And I'll say it is, but let's pray for that crooked and perverse generation. And let's have them realize and consummate their oneness with God. I'm talking about all the judges and all the international bankers and all the people in the governments. Governments. And all of the people that you know and the people that you work with. Let's have that blameless and harmless and without faith in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, and among whom you shine as lights in the world. Hey, that's nice. Boy, does this world need your light. Do that, would you? Take away all of the obstructions and all of the impedance and just shine the great light that you can be. We need you. Holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain or labored in vain. Stop running in vain. Stop laboring in vain. Just stop and think of what you're doing. The days are going by, and don't you let another minute go by without your being 100%. You're a great person. And there goes .com. Glad and rejoice with you all. Encouraged, like-minded. Like-minded is what you have with wedding presents, right? All right, like-minded, encouraged, and seek your own. And put the things first, which are first. Isn't that great? Now, I know a Methodist minister. I think they're both ministers, Methodist ministers. I think they've separated. How can that be? How can a Methodist minister separate from his wife or she from him? How can that be? A minister and a Methodist should know all this. They should work it out. Well, that's terrible. All right, I want you to pray for them, will you please? Pray for the Methodist minister and wife who separated, who just couldn't work it out. Jesus couldn't work it out. Pray for them. And since I can't get the hymns going out here, and I think it needs batteries. The CD's okay, but the speaker needs batteries. We got so interested in making you perfect that we forgot our rejoice at 10:30. My, my. I'm going to rejoice about this. If you do have a bad thought, and anything that you've done wrong in the past will come back and keep haunting you, and will keep coming to you, catch that thought and say right away, I admit it, I acknowledge it, I'm ashamed of it, I'm embarrassed by it, I'm sorry that I did it, I wished I hadn't done it, but I'm going to atone for it. If something bad happens to you, you are atoning. That's what's really happening. When people get sick, and you see them at the first time they're sick, you have to remember that something they did wrong, and this is an atonement for that. I'm sorry, but I think that's the truth. I think that's the real truth. And all the people here that I'm praying for, I believe, somewhere along, it's cause and effect. But that is not such a bad thought. That is a good thought. Because you can say, I'm sorry. I did wrong. I'm embarrassed. I hate it. I wish I hadn't done it. I want to make good for it. I want to atone. I want to restitute for it. Let it come. Let my punishment come. Get it over with. And I won't do it again. And I'll restitute. I'm sorry. I think that's the way it is. But I say that that's good in the long run. And that may be true with a Methodist minister and his wife. I'm sorry you didn't make it. You could have made it. You still can make it. You can still be your 100% perfect person. I believe that's everything to report to you. This is the end of the cycle. What's your cycle? No, I'm not talking about a bicycle. What is your cycle? You have to hold on to it. Because of the March wind. Oh, the little baby was here and Glennie didn't know that. She came here to be protected. She came here to be sheltered. She likes to be with you. And I should have picked her up and showed her to you. Remember what Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden and the cat? She is certainly the impersonation. No, the embodiment of that. Personification was the word I was looking for. Okay. So we're at the end of the cycle. What is the cycle? Well, you have to get up in the morning and do the chores, but you got to sit with God. That's the first thing. Put the God work first. Boy, what a difference that makes. You think, well, I'll never get anything done. Well, don't think that. That's when you do get things done. And so you have to take care of .com. You have to do that. You have to make the bed. You have to clean up the kitchen. You have to tidy the house. What'd the housewife say? Housewife said, housework is a drain. You wash the dishes, you make the beds, you take out the garbage, and in 2 weeks you gotta do the same thing all over again. And then comes the logs and the expenses into the book. And the devotions and the meditate and the create. And study the words. The words are very, very important. Because you have all these feelings inside of you and you can't articulate them. So the words do that for you. The English language is brilliant at articulating exactly the emotion that you're feeling. And then, 1 to 5, that's another form of prayer, writing down the goals that you feel that you have to do in your life, and then a lot of praying for other people. I just finished my prayer list for today. You're on that list. I pray for you every day, and not just once a day either, practically every hour, every quarter hour. And then comes the legal papers. This is my cycle. Here comes the legal papers. Well, fortunately, they are all up to date. There were 11 of them this week, and they're done. And here's a little insect. Okay, little insect, first day of spring, enjoy it. After the legal papers comes the renewals. The cable TV stations, 52 stations. I have to call them up, get the status, we chat with Glendora, see what channel is on, see what hour is on, see if they can return my tapes, and I'll send them a postage if they can. And then comes an hour of telephoning, and I wish it were 5 or 6 hours because there's so many people that I should call and don't call. And that's where the prayer list comes from. I hear all these bad things that are happening to people, and I'm asked to pray for them. So that's the telephoning, and then after that I have 24 problems to work out. Well, no, challenges. 24 challenges to work out. And they are working out. They always seem to work out, folks. They always seem to work out. That, again, is that oneness with God. They all seem to work out. And, I guess that's the end of the cycle. Oh, no. when you have it all done and the work is up to date, and that does happen, and the work is up to date, and then you have alone and empty. You're alone with God. Actually, it's alone and together with God. And empty means you got all the stuff done and you can relax and there's peace. How's that for a cycle? Oh, I forgot. Then there comes a chat with Glendora. You have to videotape it, which you see going on right now. And then we have to set up the title machine, you know, the words on the screen, to give you double messages to help you. And then comes the editing, where you make six dubs of about, I think this week there's going to be 12 editions, 12 half hours. You make six dubs of each one of those. And then comes the wrapping, and that takes one, this whole cycle, or rather this whole thing about a chat with Glendora, the videotaping through the wrapping, takes about 3 days. And that's the end of the cycle. I want to call Garrett Kipp and invite him again to learn public access. He's only about 11 or 12 years old, 6th, 7th grade, and teach him and pass on to him the gift of public access and how to do it, and the gift of how to do videotaping and making dubs and all those things, and doing the character generator. I want to pass that on to him. And to anybody else in the new generation, I'll pass it on to you free. I want you to have it. Let's close with a hymn. That's Marge. This hymn is for all of us. Open our eyes that we may see glimpses of love thou hast for us. Place in our hands that wonderful key that will unclasp and set us free. Silently now we wait for thee. Ready our God, thy will to see. Open our eyes, illumine us, Spirit of God.
Oh, that's perfect. 29 minutes. That's
in Prince George's County, Maryland, the land of the scam and the home of the fraud. I'm reporting today. I was down doing a story today on the demonstration at the World Can't Wait, and I heard a lot of disturbing accusations today, indictments. They read an open indictment against the President of the United States, and I believe that the President should have a right to respond to this as to what's going on. But you have to put it in the context that the people were complaining about. You know, they were complaining about the war in Iraq, and here we have the Saturday, February 4th, 2006, and here's one of the stories that they were complaining about, that large numbers of our servicemen are being made permanently disabled by this war. And these numbers aren't being reflected in the count of what's happening. So we need to get questions. And if you go back further in the paper, you've got, you know, just other recent demonstrations at the White House as to what's going on around the world, and apparently the United States isn't focused on the bigger picture of actually bringing peace to the world, but it seems to have taken an aggressive standpoint. And, you know, these people should not be forgotten. We have to have all the respect in the world for our servicemen who went overseas and in good faith and thought that they were being adequately equipped with protection devices so that they wouldn't be killed or maimed. And it goes on and on. And this is what's behind it all, right here. This is the problem behind the biggest problem with the entire campaign is people have no more faith in our government. Nancy Pelosi, the minority chairman of the House, openly calls the Congress of the United States a culture of corruption. And how did we get here? Elena Sassar was falsely arrested and imprisoned by Republican leadership. You know, here we've got, how far were the Amaroff? I was at a Democratic workshop today, as I am also not only a reporter, but I'm also an active candidate in 2005 for Maryland's 4th Congressional District, and I just received this yesterday, and I will be filling out my papers. And these things disturb the people, and they have a right to know. So this is the introduction to the program, but, you know, we need to go farther into this and find out, you know, whether the people are upset with the current leadership rightfully, and whether the House leadership and the executive branch has been lying to us. They just had an upset yesterday in the House of Representatives. And then on the back side here, you find out that here goes another $90 billion to Iraq that could feed our children in Appalachia and the starving children. And we're sending these billions upon billions of dollars over, and we're getting nowhere. This gentleman right here is the responsible party for it, for not having his troops lying to the president, not having the troops adequately prepared before they went overseas. So somebody's lying, and we need to find out who, we need to find out what's going on, and we need to get to the bottom of it. I have right here, now there were lots of allegations today that the President of the United States has lied to the people, okay? And here is the copy of Title 18 of the United States Code. And I want to read into what it says under 18 U.S.C. 1001. Okay. Whoever in any matter within the jurisdiction of any department or agency of the United States knowingly and willfully falsifies, conceals, or covers up any by any trick or scheme or fictitious fraudulent statement or fictitious scheme or device a material fact, or makes any false fictitious or fraudulent statement or representation or makes or uses the false writings or documents knowing the same to contain any false, fictitious, or fraudulent statement or entry shall be fined under the title and or imprisoned not more than 5 years or both. So everybody down there was saying that the president has lied to them. And, you know, you have to go by these laws. This is the Constitution of the United States, and that this is the only thing that matters, the Constitution. And has the president made false statements? This will come out in the congressional hearings that are about to start next week. On the wiretap fraud, where he's apparently, and I can't find anywhere in this book where it says the President of the United States has jurisdiction and authority to empower the military or Secret Service to put in special secret prisons and torture war detainees, or to put in any kind of a secret wiretap surveillance on the people of the United States. And I will ask right now, for the record, Mr. President, you can clarify this up real easy. All you have to do is have your Attorney General cite the exact laws and the statutes that support your contention to this, showing where you have that support. And that should clear up quite a bit of this controversy with these people who were demonstrating today. But, you know, people have lost the confidence in the President of the United States. And I'll be honest with you, I did not vote for George W. Bush in either time. I do believe that voter fraud was very evident in Florida. As you will see, I have some clips from Florida showing that the Human Rights Commission on Voting Rights Commission having hearings. So that all has to be taken out of. Personally, I think Mr. Bush is the first appointed president in the history of the United States. And I'm upset that William Rehnquist could nullify so many votes with one vote when it was purported that his daughter was on the election commission within the state of Florida, and he should have recused himself to begin with. But we're going to go to this. This is going to be about a 6-program series. And I will play portions of this at the beginning of each program. You're going to have 2 programs on the citizens' response to the State of the Union speech. There'll be two separate programs on that. And then there will be this program, plus there'll be at least 2 more programs on the demonstration and the speakers and the march around the White House. And we have to commend the Washington Capitol Police and District Police for an outstanding job. It's the first demonstration I've ever been in. And to stand out in the rain all day and to take it into, and they were very pleasant to everybody. It made you proud to be an American. And but before we go on to that, this is one of the reasons I don't trust this president, okay? If you see before you, this is a National Leadership Award, okay? It was granted to me by the National Republican Congressional Committee, okay? For my fine work as the honorary co-chairman of the President's Business Advisory Council for the state of Maryland. Okay? Now, I sent a letter to Ronnie Earle on the October 24th because this is a fraud, you know. If you check the Supreme Court records, for the United States Supreme Court. This is a petition that I filed in the United States Supreme Court. You will find that these documents, the original of these documents, is on file in the United States Supreme Court. I was kind of proud of them when I first got them. I thought it was a legitimate deal, but months later, when it came time for the meetings, I was totally defrauded out of everything. And you can see that on other programs. But I haven't heard back from the Honorable Ronnie Earle, District Attorney, P.O. Box 1748, Austin, Texas, 78765, and this was sent certified registered mail, so I know that he got it, okay? And what it does is, Dear Sir, I am contacting your office as a victim related to the case you are now moving forward with in the matter of the state versus Thomas DeLay campaign finance fraud and money laundering. First paragraph, I am also a victim of Congressman DeLay and other influential members of the United States Congress shaking down unsuspecting victims in what they call the President's Business Advisory Council, in which Congressman DeLay knowingly and with criminal intent and used his Texas public office and property that being his office in the United States Congress knowingly conspired with others to shake down virtually every corporation in the United States under false light and false pretenses, bringing dishonor on the great state of Texas. I will not take up your time. However, I am supplying you with 38 documents and a video documentary that I, the video documentary is on the website, on my other places on my website under Culture of Corruption. I believe there are three shows on there, and that I have produced for cable TV. That is the best evidence that Congressman knowingly conspired with others to rip me off. Since Congressman DeLay used his public facilities of Texas congressional delegation to perpetrate further this fraud, I am now asking you, is there any way that I can file either a criminal complaint with your office or a simple racketeering complaint and also in the United States District Court? A symbolic racketeering complaint in the United States District Court. I thank you for your time and consideration, and I will wait for your office's response. I have also included footage from the House Minority Leaders and the Honorable Nancy Pelosi's, in which she calls the Congressman DeLay, calls out Congressman DeLay for bringing dishonor on the United States Congress, in which he now calls a culture of corruption in our current Congress of the United States. And what is in this document is, here's a highlighted view, and it shows that, you know, Tom DeLay did send me this with with the government funds. Here is the, there's a bunch of faxes in here that I've received inviting me to various to functions to get my awards and stuff like that, but they were all fraudulent. They wanted like $28,000 for me to attend these meetings that I was the honorary chairman of, so. But let's get back to the rest of it. The allegations were put forth today, and I would respectfully request the President of the United States to see if he can counter these claims and let the people know what's going on in our and, you know, these lies are getting outrageous, you know. The president promises that we'll stay competitive, but the only way we're staying competitive is we're giving all the richest corporations tax breaks. And this is all in the Washington Post. This particular paper here was February 3rd. The Washington Post. So it's we have a problem and we need to deal with it. And so to the members and the participants in today's rally, I think that you handled yourself extremely well. There was no arrest. It was a very peaceable march, just as this, and everybody honored the rules. And now what we need to do is we need our president, you know, Mr. George W. Bush, we need you to follow the rules. As the President of the United States, this is the least that we can expect from you, is to follow the rules. And if you could please respond to this in writing as to what rules and statutes support your impaneling secret prisons, who you contacted, who authorized it, who authorized the secret wiretaps, how many secret wiretaps you have done. I'd like to know what the casualty rate is, and the whole American public is waiting to see what the real casualty rate is. And both men and equipment from this war in Iraq, what is it costing us? And how much of this military hardware is being purchased from foreign countries, since we have no longer have capacity to even furnish bullets enough for what's happening over there? This is disturbing because my grandchildren will inherit what you have started today. And I was very emotionally upset at hearing the speaker speak. So we need to get the answers to these. If you would please respond, it would be gratefully appreciated. God bless, and have a good day. And Mr. President, I hope you can clear up these things for the citizens of the United States, because, you know, basically we deserve it. We absolutely deserve it. Let me read for a second. This is a brochure, and like I said before, I am a Democratic candidate for the United States Congress. Okay? And I delivered this today to the a meeting in Rockville, thanking the campaign workers who are charged with keeping our campaigns legal and honest and above board, something we've missed in the last two elections. But I want to read a quote here. This is what I put on the bottom of the quote. Thank you to the participants of today's workshop. Commend yourselves for protecting democracy and ensuring the voters will have the last say in the direction of this nation will take in the 21st century. Forever remember what Thomas Jefferson said, and this is a quote from Thomas Jefferson, "Who will govern the governors? ?" There is only one force in the nation that can be dependent upon to keep the governors pure and the governors honest, and that is the people themselves. They alone, if well informed, are capable of preventing the corruption of power and restoring the nation to its rightful course if it should go astray. They alone are the safest depository of the ultimate power of government." And this is one of our founding fathers wrote this, so it's been recorded. The people spoke today. The people spoke. You were in Crawford, Texas, and you did not hear them. The media will only show you a very, very slight glimpse of what happened today. And I plan to put the entire story on the World Wide Web so that all peoples can see what's going on. You'll find that I have an extensive history of dealing with corruption myself, and that is on the web, but that's neither here nor there. But it's time to draw the line in the sand, and we've drawn it today. We said that we want answers from this president and from this administration as to in which direction you are going to take our government. Are you going to restore it to a government of honor? Are you going to restore it to a government of decency? Are you going to restore it to a humanitarian government that exports goodwill rather than bullets? Time will tell. God bless and have a good day.
When your children and grandchildren asked you what you did to stop the war in Iraq, tell them that you stood on the right side of history. And like that song, America, let no one tell you you're not doing the right thing. You're doing good. So you take that.
That this war criminal step down and take his whole program with him. Looking out at you today and looking at the White House when I came here this morning, I'll tell you the truth. I am sobered, but I am confident about what we're doing. That's because they may have the guns, the bombs, and all the big machinery of the media and all that, but we have the truth, and we stand for and represent the interests of the vast majority of the people in this country and on this planet, from New Orleans to Baghdad and beyond. Told us again and again, told the whole world that there was WMDs in Iraq, even though his intelligence proved all along that there wasn't. He did that. Why? Because George Bush is a liar. When George Bush stood up in front of the country and said no one could have predicted that the levees in New Orleans would break, even though the White House had been warned. Why? Because George Bush is a liar. Stood before all of us and said he didn't spy on people without warrants, went in secret more than 18 times for years. He's been approving secret illegal wiretapping on millions of people. Why? Because George Bush is a liar. And when George Bush says that our protest doesn't matter, why does he say that? George Bush is a liar. When he says we're a focus group, George Bush is a liar. When he says we don't count, George Bush is a liar. And let me ask you, does it matter that that a courageous group of students at a historically black college took up this movement to launch, to drive out the Bush regime on November 2nd, too. And it mattered even more when the school threatened them with expulsion for handing out leaflets that they raised bloody hell, and that all across this country, we united to force the school to back down. And it matters even more that they came out and put out a call and said the repression that they face proves even more why we need to be out in the streets today. We're gonna lose our power. So I'm gonna keep speaking up until...
We now know that two of the hijackers in the United States.
That's where they get all their power.
Yeah.
I mean, you got judges that have been appointed. They're compromised.
Yeah.
They have to be slaves to the people who appoint them.
Yeah.
Then the corporations pay off our lawyers, our corporations,
yeah.
You know, and then they get the power to change legislation, and
yeah.
And that's where they get their power. Then they get their power through the Supreme Court, too.
Yeah.
To the judicial system.
Yes, they do. Yeah, so
look what happened to James Traficant.
Yeah, well,
they shanghaied him off to jail because he spoke up against... Yeah. Federal Reserve System.
Yeah. And you see, here is again, you know, they couldn't prove Traficant wrong. No. They couldn't do that. And they couldn't prove former Congressman McFadden wrong in 1933,
four. What Traficant had against him was the whole network was against
them. Yeah.
They had all that power because you don't fool around with the Federal Reserve System.
Exactly,
that's like touching the third rail.
So what you have here, Albert, is exactly the same scenario. You have a cohesive, fraudulent, corrupt judicial system all in line with each other working against you.
Yeah, like I was telling you before, if I were to keep a lawyer on it, I had a lawyer on it for 2 years.
Yeah.
If I were to keep that lawyer on it, I won't have a house today.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They were taking it away from me.
Yeah.
So that's how the system.
I
was paying that man $200 an hour.
Yeah.
Right? And for the prejudgment remedy hearing, he charged me $3,195. Right? And he did everything for the judge to put an attachment on my home.
Yeah.
He helped. He helped the judge to put an attachment on my own.
Now, if there's a lawyer out there or several lawyers who would like to look into this kind of stuff for the simple purpose of being honest and the integrity and understanding the kind of stuff that the judicial system and the legal system at large is doing, you know, please write to Kowalski America. P.O. Box 2207, Meriden, Connecticut, 06450. And if you have an interest in the cases like this, let us know what you think, pro and con. We're not afraid to handle anything that comes down the old turnpike there because we're all very knowledgeable and very experienced in terms of the information that we do collect on matters such as what we're discussing here tonight. And Joe, have you seen or heard of any in your time experiences with the legality of the judicial system? Is there any cases that you have that, you know, they kind of put you off and they keep on going and going and you never get to the point?
Oh, sure. I had a case in 1963 where I broke my vertebrae, my back, so I went to see a lawyer and well, the case went on for about 3, 4, 5, 6 years. Then he got disbarred.
The lawyer got disbarred.
Then his son took over, and he had it for a few years. We couldn't get the insurance companies together. Then he got disbarred.
Yeah.
And then that went on for, then I had to wait another couple of years before I'd get the records. Then I finally got the records, and I gave them to this lawyer in Meriden, Connecticut.
Uh-huh.
And so he pussyfooted around for about 6 years with him. And then we found out later that he never even touched and looked at my records.
So now you have about maybe more than 10 years accumulated.
Maybe 40-something years. 1963.
Oh, 1963. That's right. Yeah.
So
I was talking about they fooled around with the first incident, you know, 3, 4, 5 years.
I had a lot of delays in between. So then I went to this lawyer, and then we found out other clients came forward and says, he never did nothing with my case, so we had him disbarred. So he got another lawyer.
He got him disbarred.
So then I figured, well, I'll get another lawyer, so who do I call? So I went down to Meriden, I called the lawyer, he says, well, I know him. So he says, well, I'll give you a number of another lawyer that'll take the case. So I called that lawyer, and he says, no, I can't take that case. So I called seven lawyers, and they won't testify against the lawyer or sue another lawyer.
Yeah.
So now my next thing is called the Bar Association, and they're going to give me the rigmarole of calling another lawyer, and I won't be able to get a lawyer.
Yeah.
So this has been going on for 40 years.
Yeah, well, there you have it. You see, it parallels in different circumstances precisely what you're up against here.
Well, lawyers are like organized crime.
Because
they take care of their own.
Yeah.
You can't. One cop can't talk. Inform on another cop.
Yeah.
Because they protect each other too.
Yes. Yeah.
As lawyers and judges and everybody else does.
Yes. Yeah.
It's a shame, but that's the way it is.
Yeah.
So that's the law for you in the United States. If you got big bucks, it's okay.
Yeah.
And if you got bigger bucks, you don't have to worry about getting hung.
Yeah.
You know, you can't hang a millionaire in the United States.
Yeah. And so you have the same scenario,
sure,
with few exception with the politician in the Senate and in Congress, and not to mention the White House, and so on, you know.
Yeah.
Edward, have you, pardon me there, and you were,
Well, I've been in corporate lords' offices, and I happen to know the CEO, because a buddy of mine from World War II, we went over to visit his nephew, who he sent to school, and he became a multi-billionaire.
Yeah.
And so we went to his office, and his uncle there, that was a friend of mine, was his godfather, so to speak, you know, because he put him through school and everything else.
Yeah.
So he says, this is the way things are done in Washington. So he says, sit in the office. So we sat in his office with him.
Yeah.
Private calls came in, and we listened to all the private calls with congressmen and senators.
Yeah.
And it went like this. He got a call. Okay, you need a favor? All right, consider it done. What is the favor? See, if you got big bucks, you could do anything.
Yeah. Exactly.
So then later on, he got a call, and he says he needed a favor, and he needed zoning changes, you know, to develop property. Here we go.
Here we go.
and then the one of the staff says, well, we'll run them in the ground. We'll bankrupt them.
Yeah.
And
See the parallel again, Albert?
Yeah. Because these people are all connected to this network.
Yes.
I mean, it's all loaded with judges and lawyers and corporations.
Yeah.
And that's the way it is. They're just a bunch of crooks. Oh, the other way to launder the money, what they do is they have a construction crew.
Yeah.
And, okay, Congressman, we'll send a crew down today and renovate your whole house.
Yeah.
Or paint your house, or build a pool.
Yeah.
Or something like this. This is the way it is. And he let us, he was sleeping with the same woman the presidents were sleeping with. This guy.
When was this?
Oh, about 20, 30 years ago.
20, 30 years ago, huh?
Yeah. And in fact, he went knocking at the door. Mrs. Brown, all these big politicians know who Mrs. Brown is, because you've probably been there yourself, you older guys, the older politicians. So one day he went to visit Mrs. Brown. They went, and there was all these FBI agents along in the hallway, and he went to knock at the door, and the FBI agent grabbed him by the hand. He says, what are you here for? He says, I have an appointment with Mrs. Brown. They said, well, you can't see Mrs. Brown today. And so he left, and he waited in his car, and old Jack comes walking out later on combing his hair. So, so there you go. And then Lyndon Johnson inherited Mrs. Brown. Brown, you know. So he had her. So that was the end of that.
Yeah.
And that's the way it is there. I mean, that's what all these Washington parties are all about, wheeling and dealing.
Yeah.
And they leave the citizens hanging, and that's why you're overtaxed, and that's why we're all going down the tube, because these guys don't give a damn about nothing.
Yes.
All they care about is themselves, and you're just cannon fodder. Believe me, they've already made up their mind 3-4 years ago to open up the borders because the corporations told them to do so.
Yeah.
And we are all sold down a pike, folks, and we're going down fast. And you better start stocking up on beans and all kinds of lentils and stuff like that, because we're going down. And all of you people living on the edge, you've had it. You're going to lose your homes and everything else, believe me.
And it's amazing how they use the legal procedures to gain access to this, because this is what the average person will respond to, you know?
Yep.
A judge, you know, the black robe.
Yeah, the black robe. Well, the devil's robe, that's what it is.
The devil's robe.
Angels wear white robes.
Yeah. Yeah.
The devils wear the black robes.
Yeah. As in the book Men in Black.
There you go.
Black. Yeah, right. Edward,
sure.
Can you give us some examples of running with the judicial system, or do you know any cases that is similar to what Joe Saloni and Albert Lebrun explained?
Well, I haven't had any personal run-ins with the system, but I was just thinking, as Joe was speaking, I've been starting to look at the Godfather programs. I think they were like 6-hour long or 2-hour programs, whatever it was, and just reviewing those and how the mafia was tied into this whole thing, you know, and the Godfather had connections with all the influential judges and politicians in New York and all that, you know. So, I mean, it is a rather sick system altogether.
Yeah,
it is. I mean, it's one big serpical system. That's what it is.
Yeah.
You know, organized crime.
Yeah. You know, have you noticed on the TV programs, you know, that there's several legal cases, you know, TV shows, hours.
Yep.
There's all kinds of legal stuff up there. You know, they have court cases, all kinds where criminal element and lawyers. Well, this doesn't represent the truth out there. This is mostly fictitious scenarios to make good TV propaganda films. But the judicial system, you know, the judges and everything here, we had Judge Napolitano, for example, you know what I mean? The chaos. In the judicial system.
Yeah, you wrote a good book also.
Yeah.
Well, I had another run-in with a politician type of thing. I go back to the war now. We hiked 45 miles one day in Italy, up the highway, and so a lot of the Gulf War guys were bragging how they went 45 miles in one day. Yeah. We walked it. We never rode in vehicles.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, after that hike, 45-mile hike, I asked the guy, the new replacement next to me, how come with all the technology we have in the United States, we don't have a gun that shoots semi-automatic and automatic by the push of a button? He said, we do have that gun. It's a Johnson gun.
Yeah.
I said, why don't we have this gun? And he says, well, because you ever heard of the fight from 10 percenters in Washington? I said, what's that? He said, well, the Browning Automatic Company pays them 10% of the profit from Browning Automatic to keep the Johnson gun off the market. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I said, you mean they're jeopardizing our lives for money? The cervical system. Yeah.
This is the 5 and 10 percenters.
The 5 and 10 percenters. So, folks, congressmen and senators are just dogs. Let's face it. I mean, they know what's going on. They're like the cervical system. They can't. Yeah. They know what's going on, but they won't report. It's like the police. They won't report on their own. Their own, even though their own are crooks and mobsters and whatever you want to call it, and doing drugs.
Yeah.
And so that's the way it is. That's what Jefferson said once. He said, don't talk to me about honorable men. I want to bind these men by the Constitution.
Yeah.
That's why we got to live by the Republic for which it stands. Those are the laws of the Constitution.
Right, yeah.
You know? And,
okay, ladies and gentlemen, I just want to inform you again that if you're interested in writing to us regarding this kind of situation that we're discussing on the lawyers and the courts, write to Full Audits America, P.O. Box 2207, Meriden, Connecticut, 06450. We'd like to hear from you. And if you're interested, you can call us up here and let us know if you have any cases. You don't have to give your name or anything. Just tell us what town you're calling from. And I want to read this here. Treason, the international conspiracy of the lawyers to destroy the United States from within. Since the biggest crimes in the world are committed in the courtrooms by lawyers and lawyer judges against the people in unconstitutional courts, we the people must protect ourselves where we need the most protection, in the courtrooms, from the lawyers and lawyer judges, who are the main criminal enterprise in this country.
That's run by
a criminal enterprise here. And you see, we sit here in front of the cameras at our wonderful studios in Walton, Connecticut, and speak openly about this thing here. And I'm waiting to hear from a lawyer out there, or even a judge who's tuned into the program, to hear any remarks regarding our program.
I have something here from Judge Scalia, and I'm proud of him for what he said here. Supreme Court judge. He says, a living constitution doesn't exist. I'm what you call an originalist, one who believes the Constitution should be interpreted exactly as it was adopted. It should be interpreted as it was written. Nothing more, nothing less. Rights do not grow smaller or larger. Some legal experts say you have to interpret the Constitution broadly, but that's not true. Under any circumstance, the Constitution is not a living document. It's a legal document, and the legal documents do not change. But we must apply the words as they were originally written, and we must be bound by their original meaning. We must think of what the words are and what the words meant. When the people adopted them, the Constitution doesn't morph to be what we want it to be. And that's absolutely correct.
We have a call here. Good evening, caller.
Hi, Mr. LeBron. I was just curious. You've been fighting this case for...
Well, what town are you calling from?
I'm calling from Hartford.
Hartford, okay.
And I was just wondering, you've been fighting this case for 15 years. Do you have any idea how long you plan to continue fighting it?
The rest of my life.
The rest of your life, yeah. So however long it takes.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I applaud your efforts. It's amazing.
They know right now that they are wrong 100%, but they don't want to admit it, because if they do admit it, they know very well that they're going to have to pay me back for what I put out there.
Right.
So that's why they keep the attachment on, the lien on, and everything else.
Mm-hmm. Well, good for you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, lady, for calling.
Okay, thanks.
You have a nice evening.
Thanks, you too.
Well, I'm into Mayan by over 40 years, my case.
Yeah.
1963.
Yeah. My. Yeah. And it goes on and on and on. Edward, do you have any comments to give us on the subject, some viewpoints or infusions?
Well, I always wonder how, as a practical matter, can we make the system work better? I mean, it's easy enough to sit back and criticize the system because it has so many faults.
Yeah.
But how do we get from here to a workable, fair, just system? That is the challenge.
Well, that's what Jefferson said. We ought to bind these men by the Constitution, like Judge Scalia just said here. It's what it means. We don't change it. We don't change the First Amendment. We don't change the Second Amendment. And that's the way it should go, by the law. Yeah. And we don't want any of these idiots out there, or congressmen or senators, changing the Second Amendment or the First Amendment.
And they're gonna
bind us with this new hate crime law, and then we won't be able to even complain about the politicians when that comes.
Yes.
So we're really going to be under a dictatorship.
Yeah.
And that's where it's what it's coming to.
They're on the way to suppress this kind of programming here. They are.
Yeah.
But we do not discriminate against anyone or anything here. This is not a question of discrimination against the judicial or the lawyer system here. It is a representation of irrefutable facts. We do a lot of research on here, especially Albert Lebrun here has done an enormous amount of research on the very subject here. And if you had found something that was honest and good about it, you would have told me.
Exactly.
You would have told the audience out there by now. You know, and you have gone into it very much the whole way here. What you are up against here and what we are up against here in terms of the country itself is a den of wolves.
Sure is.
Yeah, yes.
That's what
we
have here.
Yes.
And please take down this website, sir, AmericanFreePress.net. AmericanFreePress.net. That's one word. And ConnecticutKangarooCourt.com. ConnecticutKangarooCourt.com. That's also one word.
Kangaroo Court?
Yeah, KangarooCourt.com, yeah. And USAExposure.com. USAExposure.com. All this is one word. And, of course, the prerequisite triple W's. And we are live here in 8 different towns. We got Andover, we got Bolton, Allenton, Hebron, Marlborough, Tallinn, Rockwell, and Vernon. And the lady was calling from
Hartford.
I didn't realize we
that's great.
All went to Hartford, which is very, very nice.
Yeah.
So this is what we do here, and we do it all the time, and we're the most watched program in the state of Connecticut because we expose this thing more. And here's what's coming down the turnpike, and it's here already. It's toward a police state. Can the camera zoom in a little bit on this? There it is, right in the middle there. And you see it here toward the police state, and that's what we have. Here's the Gestapo. Here's the Gestapo here. And that's what you're looking at. And we're straight out as can be on it. And this is why they harass me, because I dare to speak out on it like this here. Now, you go back into the Bible. You know, what did they do with Christ? They killed him. What did they do with the apostle? They killed them, because they couldn't take the statement of truth, that is the Roman Empire at the time. You happen to have that statement with you, the comparative statement?
I sure do. Give me a minute.
All yeah, right. go ahead and find it. We got plenty of stuff to talk about. Albert, I want to get back to you a little bit more here. Can you tell our viewers, audience out there, some more about your case here?
Right, right. Some people may say why he is not paid for it, right? We took a my wife took a polygraph test then.
A polygraph test?
Right. Okay. Then those girls were told not to come on that property 2 months before this incident.
Right? Yeah. They were warned. And, you.
And they deny it on the oath. They denied and they never, how that's make you feel?
Yeah.
A 14-year-old girl who's going to say that my wife is a liar and she's honest, right?
Yeah.
Right? So you feel so terrible, right?
Yeah.
And there's no two way about it. I do believe in a polygraph test because when the question was asked, she feel an electric shock. They make you lie there, right? Mm-hmm. And when she make the lie, right, they give you 6 cards and you hide one of them. And then they name those cards and all that, and they make you lie. When they name the right card, then she's got to hide. She lie, and she feel an electric shock in her finger. Mm-hmm. So I do believe in those tests, my friend. And young girl is gonna perjure themselves, and Larry Flatow is gonna untie your dog, and do all those things. And the court wants me to pay a criminal. To me, they are criminal. They are perjurer and criminal, right? So you don't feel like they don't deserve. To me, criminal doesn't deserve a penny. Right? So that's why I fight for.
So where are you now in your case?
I file motion to vacate those attachments and those lien, and it's always the same judge who decided, Klazak from Summer, and deny. Yeah. They don't do nothing no more, but they deny. They deny my motion.
Yeah, right? They deny the motion, yeah. Well, it's a confused world out there, and it takes a level-headed person to understand how serious the situation is in this country here. We haven't got much time, so you can get off your couch potato. But how do we wake people? How do we make people understand? I have tried all sorts of methods to try to convince people that they should get up and do something.
Well, it goes something like this. You get this guy that had a bunch of baby chicks, gooselings, or goslings, whatever you call them.
Yeah.
When they hatch, they saw him. He was the father.
Yeah.
Right? And the father could never do anything wrong.
So could we say in a sense that so when the president or a Congress or a politician comes on TV, they become a father figure as a medium by which to solve all their problems?
Yeah, there you go. So the little baby chicks follow the man, and they grow up, and they follow him, and they fly with his ultralight plane.
Yeah.
And so if somebody told those goose, geese, whatever they are, that's not their father.
Yeah.
That's your real father is the goose over here.
Yeah.
They would scorn him and say, the man is his father, and they can't tell him any different. And that's the way young people are.
Yeah.
They're growing up through Hollywood BS, you know, and they get taken over by that syndrome. Go ahead.
We have another call here. Good evening, caller. Where are you calling from?
Vernon, Connecticut.
Welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'd like to ask Mr. LeBron a question, please. I've been reading the Hartford Current and the J.I., and I've read about his situation for many, many months and years. I've still seen articles. And I'd like to ask him, everything that the Hartford Current or J.I. wrote pertaining to his situation in the case, does he believe all of this is true?
No, it's not true. The Hartford Courant been destroying me and the GI the same for the last 10 years. They've been leaving me alone now for 4 years, but they've been destroying me. What you got in the Hartford Courant is a bunch of lies. And if you do receive the Hartford Courant, I will suggest cancel your subscription right now and do the same with the GI. Right? If they cannot say nothing in their paper, then lie you don't want to read it. So cancel, and I suggest for everybody to cancel their subscription. This way, maybe they will learn to put the truth in their paper.
Lady, one of the reasons the papers go along sort of carte blanche with the judicial system is and the corporation is because advertising. If they go against the system to a degree, they hold that club over the head of the newspapers in terms of taking advertising revenues away, and the newspapers are already hurting bad because there's a lot more news on the internet than in the news media. So this is one of the reasons that the newspapers sort of back off from being really investigating cases. They should have had all sorts of articles on you favoring the respect for truth, but they can't do that because they have this thing hanging over their head.
Commercialism.
Commercialism, the advertising, the money system there.
So most of the articles then that they wrote about Mr. LeBron are false. So they're persecuting him without really knowing the story themselves.
I spent an hour and a half with Dan Hurlinger in my home and I explained to him all the document, false document that I was served with and all that. And the next morning he had a story about me, and instead of saying anything about the false document and all that, he run a story to destroy me some more. So that's the kind of a newsman that you do have with the Hartford Courant.
Well, I think I'm beginning to believe it. And I thank you and wish you lots of luck.
Mention one more thing to you?
Certainly.
Many newspapers, including the Hartford Courant, calls me up and ask me if I want to subscribe to the paper.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, like the Hartford papers and New Haven Register and other papers, including all the way down to the New York Times. And I invited the news reporter to come up to Meriden and meet with me at McDonald's there to discuss the value of news media versus the value of the articles that I have. And he said he was going to come up and discuss it with me. And I said, if you do, I'll subscribe to your paper for a year. And he never showed up. I sat there for 30 minutes with my coffee getting cold at McDonald's in Meriden, and he never showed up.
Well, then we should watch your channel.
Yes. This is what we do, and we thank you very much for tuning into our program, lady. You're a very nice lady, and you have a nice evening, and thank you again.
Well, thank you all.
Bye-bye.
I'd like to add, Arnie, that's why this cable company we're on with now is the only free press there is, because it's non-commercial.
Yeah.
And that's the reason. Yeah. So everybody's, like I say, there's that network, folks. You can't fool around that network because they have corporations in there, and they control everything. In fact, there's six corporations that own all the news media, printed news media, and TV in the United States.
Yeah.
And they all belong to that network. And in fact, I'll get that thing on the CFR and the Trilateral Commission, which is the members are all people from the press. We're talking about all of them. And David Rockefeller is the head honcho of the CFR and Trilateral Commission, and he funds it, and that's his farm.
Yeah.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
And you have congressmen in there, you have all the news media, corporations, and I have it here, and I'll read it off as soon as I find it.
Okay, I have a book here, The Roosevelt Myth. John T. Flynn was a personal advisor and organizer for FDR in the 1930s there. And I'm going to just read a short thing out of the book here. And here it says, the charge that Roosevelt had been playing a game of irresponsible experimentation with the American people as guinea pigs. How do you like that? I mean, this is a recorded statement. This is not fiction of me or anyone else here or anywhere. This is a provable, documented criteria. This is a biographical fact that comes in here. I'm going to read it again. This is just a short part of the quote here. It goes on and gets scarier as you read it. The charge that Roosevelt had been playing a game of irresponsible experimentation with the American people. And you, my friend here and we all here are guinea pigs.
Right.
And that's a flat, unabridged, unadulterated, and unbiased statement.
Well, finish the sentence, sorry. There was an incomplete statement there.
Yeah, well, I just didn't want to read the whole thing. It goes on to the whole chapter, the whole thing there. But I just want to illustrate the certain things about that it goes on with the stuff. And as I say, it gets hairier as you start reading into it. Here's another aspect out of this book here. In the bad days of the 1930s, after the crash on Wall Street, which was an organized effort to do, a planned effort to do, the Roosevelt administration would go around the country and to buy votes for people who didn't have any money to buy food. He says, all right, if you vote for Roosevelt, we'll give you money to buy food. That's on record. That's on record. So, but I can't quote the whole thing because then I start reading the book instead of quoting from it, you know. But this is the facts of it, and this is what we have on our heads here. Joe, I see you found that piece of documentation.
Yeah, I had it for a while.
This is a comparative sort of evaluation between the Roman Empire and the Empire of the United States of America.
Yep. This is the Roman Empire just before it collapsed.
That's
2,000
right.
years ago.
Yeah. This is 2,000 years ago.
Most powerful nation on earth, economically, militarily, but politically there is sharp division between both parties of the Senate. The people themselves are sharply divided over serious social issues. There have been major revisions in the tax system. No kidding. Massive immigration is creating serious issues along the border. Mm-hmm. Unbelievable, huh? There is wide... I had this copied and the words doesn't look...
Widespread?
Let me skip that. Diversity within the country. Racial animosities and violence. Unrest, strife, both home and abroad.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes, we have.
Yep. Military upheavals and conflict all over the world. Isn't that incredible? Mm-hmm. Sex scandals among prominent politicians and leaders.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my goodness is right. Widespread corruption that is regularly reported among politicians. You believe that? I don't think that's right. They shouldn't say that. Bribery and payoffs. I don't believe that. Do you?
No, it is. No, our government is honest as can be.
Revelations of espionage. Oh, what the heck? We got a lot of that. And an absence of strong leadership. Immoral leadership. The country is rampant with sexual immorality. I don't think so. Do you?
We haven't seen anything, have we?
No.
Huh?
Prostitution, flagrant sexual deviancy, explicit sex is sold and viewed by many. Try television, right? Extreme and cruel violence is commonplace. The military is overextended. Does that sound familiar to you?
Gee, I didn't realize that, Joe.
The recruiting standards are constantly being lowered. I never heard of that, did you?
I thought we had the best military money could buy.
Oh, yeah. There are, there's another one that's scratched out a little bit. Overall, low moral among the armed forces. There's another one. Christianity is not popular with the intelligentsia as well as with many liberal leaders. Self-interest, indulgent, and personal ambitions are the primary concerns of the people. Very true. There have been major revisions in the tax system. The judicial system favors the wealthy and influential. Do you think so?
Yes.
There is growing hostility and resentment by other nations.
Wow.
Wow, huh? Isn't that amazing?
Oh, yes.
And a growing gap between the haves and have-nots. All describe the Roman Empire at some point in its last 200 years. And there you are. History repeats itself.
2,000 years ago, ladies and gentlemen, this is bona fide truth for you.
Could I say one more thing?
Absolutely, Joe.
See, they took the Ten Commandments out of the school, right?
Yes.
And if we don't have the Ten Commandments, there's no way we could survive. It's totally impossible for this country to survive. And maybe they didn't have it at that time here during the Roman Empire. They did partially, probably.
Yeah, they didn't have the Ten Commandments. But they did have a republic, you know. Yeah. I mean, you go back into Solon, you know, which is what the lawmakers are called, you know, when you go up there, and that's what it, and that's in 596 B.C., you know, in Egypt, the Solon are from Greek there, you know. Mm-hmm. This is what you trace the history of mankind down there, and you go back into Arnold Toynbee, the eminent British historian and Freemason. He said there have been 23 notable civilizations.
Yeah, there you go. That's what I'm going to say.
And 19 out of 23 perished for exactly what's happening here in the United States today. This is what we have. Do you have anything to add to the fray here?
Well, it's just that, in theory, our country is still a constitutional republic. In practice, it's a fascist country run by the powerful, the rich, the business executives, the military-industrial complex, and it is definitely an empire.
Absolutely an empire. An empire. And that's why I say, you know, you compare the Roman Empire to the Empire of the United States of America. Mm-hmm.
Some people just don't get it, you know.
Albert, do you ever get any response anywhere from any lawyers, except in the negative sense?
No, I try lawyers everywhere. I try lawyers as far as Jerry Spence in Jackson Hole, Wyoming.
Yeah.
I try lawyers in New York and Long Island, and in New York and Broadway.
Yeah.
I try in Rhode Island, I try in Maine.
Yeah.
Right? No lawyer will help me here, except I could get a lawyer to give me a scoop. Yes, I could get a lawyer, right? To take the attachment off my home, I bet a lawyer will do that.
Yeah.
They'll sign everything, and I won't be able to get back at them, right?
Yeah.
I spend all kind of money here, and I want it back. You understand?
Absolutely. Now, you know, the Bar Association is not limited to Connecticut or any state or this country. It's an international organization that works together a great deal, all these people here. Lawyers and lawyer judges created unconstitutional lawyer system, pre-trial motions and hearings to have eternal extortionistic litigation. Did you hear that? Did you hear that?
Yeah, yeah.
It's an extortion racket that we're dealing with here. And I'm brave enough to come and say that this is a criminal enterprise. And why is it legally operating a criminal enterprise in the state of Connecticut and elsewhere?
Because
why is it that no one is taking these people to account? Isn't it someone out there who recognizes these things and lowers the hammer?
Nobody has the courage.
Isn't there anybody
that
comes out of the woodwork to do this?
Well, actually, a lot of people are starting to speak out because they're very angry. Just about anybody who has, you know, been through the legal system, whether as a plaintiff or a defendant, comes away from the experience very unhappy.
Yeah.
So you build up an ever-growing army of people who are unhappy with the system.
Yeah. So
it puts a great deal of pressure on it to be changed.
So we're building a case in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
With the I'm going to mention that we Kelo versus the City of New London. You know, the eminent domain thing. Here's another criminal enterprise par excellence that takes people who doesn't want to give their house away. They come in there with the judicial supremacy.
That's the developers, like when I was at the corporate lawyer's house building there. I mean, they wanted to bury the landowner so the corporations could take over his land.
Yeah.
And they were getting the help from congressmen to do it.
Yeah.
You know, I got an article here from even President Jackson. Here's an example. President Jackson openly accused the bank of meddling in politics by granting loans to the congressmen to influence legislation.
Mm-hmm.
And it's still happening today, folks. There's still influence legislation. It never ends. I mean, it's like the organized crime, the mafia.
Yeah.
It goes from one family to another. So, I mean, people called in here once and they said, yeah, but that happened years ago. Nothing changes, folks. I just read off the Roman Empire and Jackson here, and it's been going on for generations.
Yeah.
And they inherit. The Bushes are inheriting. Their crime family. They are a crime family.
Yeah.
Prescott Bush sold gas and oil to the Germans during World War II with the Rothschilds, who was the biggest godfather of them all. And the Rothschild family is worth $100 trillion all over the world. And you showed that picture with the tentacles spread all over the world.
Yeah.
And that's true. And the David Rockefeller and his family are worth $12 trillion.
Yeah.
So what do these guys want? They want power. That's all they want. Money doesn't count no more.
Yeah.
Why don't they take $1 billion and just retire and get us out of our hair, for Christ's sake?
Well, you know, here we have, Albert, in a sense, they're trying to take your property and your life by eminent domain through the criminal, power of the criminal system.
Where does the Bar Association come in on this, with things like this?
Well,
I mean, I can't get any lawyers.
No, but this is, they're part of the system, you know.
They're organized crime.
Yeah, it's an organized, par excellence, indeed.
Yeah.
And I'll illustrate to on some other cases from other parts of the country where the same scenario exists. They are defrauding our private property. They're demolishing freedom through eminent domain. Yep. This is what they're doing here. Let me read to you from American Free Press, AmericanFreePress.net, if you go to the internet. August 1, 2005. I'm going to read this. Part of it here, I'm going to read a little bit here on the article. Jim Corbin of New Buffalo Township in Michigan has been selling used Volvo automobiles with no hassles for some 30 years. His father had passed the business on to him. Corbin recently was slapped with more than $3,000 in fines and court costs after township officials cited him for not having a local license to sell the Volvos. Bear in mind, he's been doing this for some 30-odd years and never had a problem. Then some big-time inside the bureaucracy of this town in Michigan here, the New Buffalo Township in Michigan.
Well, paid-off politicians.
Started to flex their muscles, you see. Now, this is a form of extortion here. Legal extortion, because it's the lawyers who's behind that. Remember, this country is not a country, it's a corporation, ladies and gentlemen.
It's a corporation.
We are not a nation, we are a corporation. And you look at the town meetings, what do they say at the town meeting? Corporation counsel. That's the lawyer for the government. Corporation, they didn't say the lawyer for the local governments, or the local town hall, or the local town or city. No, it's corporation council. And it's under the jurisprudence, ladies and gentlemen, of Britain. We have no country. We have a corporation. General Motors is a corporation. Ford is a corporation. Microsoft is a corporation. But are you a citizen of a corporation? I have never heard of it. And it doesn't exist. So here we have this official here coming, citing him for not having been doing it for 30 years. Is this helping businesses in the state of Michigan?
No.
Is this
Originally, licenses were issued for things which were inherently dangerous activities.
Yeah.
And in other words, you needed to get somebody's permission to do something which was inherently dangerous.
Yeah.
Now, selling a car is not inherently dangerous.
Right, yeah.
And in fact, he had, you know, a long time been doing this. So, what do you say, 30 years?
Yes.
And so now, at some point, the township enacted a statute that you had to have a license to have, a business, any business, probably. And he might not even have been aware of that. But that is the thing. Basically, it was a tax raising and control mechanism.
It's a legal system of extortion that's coming up. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're running out of time on our first hours here. We got about a minute left to go. So any quick remarks, very quick remarks?
Well, I'm just going to mention my sister down in Florida, Lady Lake,
don't
Florida.
Don't talk too much now because we don't have the time.
Yeah, okay. Well, we don't have the time, so...
Yeah, well, that's why
I say... Is this program going to be over or what?
Well, we have an hour that we're done here, so... We're going to say good night to our audience, and thank you very much for the ones who called in and asked us questions, and we appreciate your tuning in tonight. Have a nice evening.
For evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing, and nothing, that's what America's doing.
And Mount Burke. And Mount Burke, right?
That's all. That's right.